The relationship started because of music, and I think the music helped them form this bond that was pretty deep in terms of friendship and a certain amount of brotherhood. And when conflict arose between them, and there was this tension because Hector wasn't as disciplined when it came to showing up.
It's me.
Yeah? It's you? Yeah. Fuck you, it's you. I know it's you. I'm not Bucci, I'm not Jerry, I'm not Ralph. It's me.
Willie, I think, made an amazing decision to say, you know what, in order to save this relationship and for us to still continue working together, I have to not be on the same stage as you.
He was always surrounded by people, but like he was filled with loneliness. So he never really found that true happiness. That's why he went for drugs. Singing was his happiness. He escaped from all this. But when we got home, it was always problems here. His friends were using him, because everybody used him. Everybody was just using him, sucking him dry. Mm-hmm. Eddie is a composite of five friends who were like always leeching on him and living off him. And at the end, Eddie's the one who's always there. You know, I think there's a jealousy between Pucci and Eddie for Hector, because they both live off Hector.
For some reason, when you're rich and famous, you're not going to find too many people to tell you no about anything or that you're doing anything wrong, especially when you're the one filling their pockets and they're on every guest list and they get free drugs and the limos and let's fly here and let's fly there. You're not going to find many people that are going to be like, Hector, man, if you continue living like this, I can't be a part of it. I'm going to move on. Give me a break. So I call those people the enablers. Even though they come and bring him bags of heroin, they made sure that he got back to the room safely. I'm like, when what you're doing is worse than you can imagine. Oh, yeah, but I took care of him. Are you kidding me?
Nice. Oh, it is. I can tell him. Have you done this before?
Lock it up. Stand by.
Action.
God. That was a bad idea.
Some of us in life are opportunists in whatever we do, but there's still this love for the guy that you are living off.
How does anybody ever leave this place, man?
We all have a human quality, even though some of us are bad boys, some of us have a habit, some of us are crackheads, some of us are dealers, but, you know, we're still human.
Que muchas veces nosotros estamos detrás de la cámara y sentimos, ¿no? ese peso emocional de este personaje que va deteriorándose, casi desconociendo inclusive todo lo que la vida le ha dado en ese momento. Entonces, obviamente, uno se lamenta y lo siente dentro de sí, ¿no? O sea que sí, aporta mucho en esa dirección.
There's this television show called Intervention that I used to watch before I started this movie. On a daily basis, if it wasn't for a show like this, you wouldn't see the darkness of addiction, right? But now, when I look at an addict, whenever a show comes on, I'm like, what is causing that? When before it was probably like, oh, get up, you know, pull yourself up from your bootstraps and get over it. You understand? Now it's like, no, hold on, don't be so quick to judge. Do not be so quick to judge, please. Just listen to the story. Everybody has their stories and their motivation for dulling pain and running. So I'm not so quick to judge.
Send another green.
Let's go, right?
Oh, yeah, here we go. We gotta lock it up.
That's how it's going to Kino.
You ever got your
I did, thank you. Here we go. Lock it up.
Hector would cry because he hated his voice.
His singing voice.
See, his singing voice. He would cry in Pucci's arms constantly. He goes, I don't know why anybody likes me. I don't understand that. I hate my voice. I don't know what happened in his life, or what his dad told him, or what issues he had with it. He felt like a fraud in a certain way. Like, why all this adoration? I don't get it, man. There were times I had to film very, very uncomfortable scenes of him dulling his pain. And I came to this conclusion during the filming of the movie, in justifying, and I hate saying this, but it's like, oh my God, if anybody needed to dull it, I had to understand if I was gonna be him. And I totally understood. No le quedaba otro remedio. It's like it's either that or what?
I
ayuda mucho y aporta mucho en la vida de todo ser humano, el vivir y ver la vida de otra persona como fue la vida de Héctor Lavoe, que lo tuvo todo. Uh-huh. Y lamentablemente a lo mejor no se dio cuenta, o sencillamente es parte del proceso de vida de un ser humano que tiene que ser así.
I say we should call the movie The Tragedy of Hector Lavoe. You know, we always marvel at artists who are so destructive and tragic and live these tormented lives, but through that comes great art sometimes, and it's almost like that's what their life was meant to be, a sacrificial lamb in a way. Mm-hmm. It's like God said, you have this talent, you're going to bring joy to millions of people, that's what you're going to do, but you're going to suffer beyond belief to do that.
There are people that resign themselves to just, no, you know what, it's in the books, whatever it is, I'm just gonna go. Yeah, but you also have to be responsible. You can't just leave your children alone at home and think, no, well, that's how God wanted it, because I feel like leaving. Like, okay, in many ways, you are in control of your destiny. You are, and you have to be aware of that.
Can you come in here?
Yeah, I gotta get my camera, man.
I felt like saying, if he just said this, at this point, if he just didn't walk through that door this particular day, this wouldn't have happened. You know, just this day, but you know what? He was hell-bent on doing it, and he decided to do it, and look, you know, and so it made me examine that you do have a lot more responsibility. You do have a lot more control over what they say your destiny is.
I think he was a role model because you learn from people's mistakes. When you're on that path of destruction, you're not aware of it. You're not like consciously aware that you're destroying yourself, you know? And so if there's someone there to consciously remind you, like, look, this is what happens when you go that way, mm-hmm. you're gonna go that way. If I was growing up and I had a musical inclination in me, I would say, I wanna do what he did and I don't wanna fall down. I want to keep going.
First of all, I'm fucking here, okay? I'm not a ghost. Yo vine a cantar. I came to sing, bro. Eddie, tell the man not to fucking
hey,
leave,
you
okay?
Guys gonna go anywhere.
The band is here. I'm here. I'm the only one here. This one's on me. You guys fix out your fucking problems. But I'm gonna sing, bro. Fuck off.
One of the very few films, or maybe the only film that I've ever been on, that people are like, oh, tomorrow's the last day. You know what I mean? It's like, oh, I don't want to go. It's just, it's been the type of project that every single day has been fulfilling. And the whole thing has been so involved in the fact that we have been making something very special.
All films are dear to you. I've done movies about Cuba. I've done New York films like Piñero. It all came down to this. I have the feeling this one is like much, much bigger than we all thought. And it got so much better and better and better.
This is another one that I could be proud of. This is one that I waited for. It happened at the right moment. I was mature enough to understand the responsibility of taking on such a role. And that's why it's been so fulfilling to me. Had I done this 5-10 years ago, I definitely wouldn't have walked away with what I'm walking away with now.
This is my first real baby. This is our little thing, you know what I mean? And I just hope that, you know, all the love and all of the heart and soul that every single person on this movie put into it translates. Because if it does, then it's gonna be amazing.
Yo soy el cantante.